Okay, I think we're good to go. So what we're going to cover today, if I go to where our overview information's at, last month we did USPS and USAS. Now, all of this information that is listed here in this upper area has been updated, including the inventories agenda. And the PowerPoint has been updated. The inventory recordings obviously will get updated after this week. But the information down here with these links, what we do is we take the entire day's worth of that recording. So, for example, payroll the very first day, we take that, even though that could be a 2-hour session, we segment that and break it down into specific areas that we cover. Just for ease of, for new users that want to come in and just learn about the different ways to add an employee, they can go directly to that portion of the recording and get that information. So these breakdowns have not been updated yet with this year's overview. So hopefully we'll get that done and out there within the next few weeks. And we'll probably be announcing this in our May newsletter, just again to let ITCs and districts know that these links are out here. And for anyone new or just wanting to get a refresher on how to do a specific process in any of our applications, they can go to those specific links here and get that. So it sounds like these have been used quite often, so we're really happy about that. So yes, these will get updated soon. So today we are going to go over inventory. I'm just going to click on our agenda here, just so you can see what we're covering specifically today. That's going to be all about transactions. So we're going to basically hit the transaction menu hard and go through the different options in there. We are going to talk about core as well. It's just so much to talk about with core, pretty basic. We'll talk about that as well as transactions. And then at the end of our session today, we'll talk about importing transactions as well. And all we're going to talk about at that point is just the system import for importing items that have an acquisition date in the current year. The non-migration import steps, we're going to cover that on Friday after we get through depreciation. We'll talk about that. Because I know that you guys are going to have districts that didn't migrate over from Classic and didn't and haven't used maybe a Classic EIS, or maybe they did a long time ago and they want to get started again. Those steps underneath the non-migration, we'll go over those so that you guys are prepared for those type of things, because there are certain things that need to be done in order. So we'll definitely go through that. But today we're going to focus on transaction processing. I'm going to go back here. And like I said, I did update the inventory PowerPoint. Believe it or not, probably you guys will believe it though. There was a lot of changes taking place in inventory the last year. A lot of issues with balancing and just additional enhancements that have been made, that first year that really people started using inventory full time was 22, and people were migrating that year. So last year, 23 was the first year that we were officially, working, heavily in the inventory system. So, with that came a lot of changes, JIRA issues created to correct issues or to add additional enhancements that weren't on the initial release. So, as I started reviewing our PowerPoint from last year, I did tweak quite a few things, in the PowerPoint that I thought would be helpful for this year's session. And so I'm just going to go to that PowerPoint. I've got it pulled up already. And like I said, today we're just going to cover the transactions, but I'm not going to reference the PowerPoint a whole lot. I'm going to try and demo per slide. So you guys feel free to, follow along by, you know, using the PowerPoint as, you know, supplementing with that. But I'm actually going to be in the inventory instance the majority of the time going through all of this. So any questions before we get started? Okay. All right, so I'm going to get rid of this and I'm going to go into my inventory instance here. So, you know, I don't know how many of you are comfortable with inventory. This is just still new to you. You're a newer ITC staff member and you're just kind of getting your feet wet with this. And that's okay. That's what this session's for. It's just to kind of give you an overview of how the system works, basically. And so the first thing we're going to go into is I'm going to talk about the core menu. Won't be talking about it too long. There's not a whole lot in here that requires a lot of attention. You know, districts that migrated over from Classic, they are going to actually, all of their core account information migrated over. So if they had a bunch of locations set up, they had funds, you know, organization codes, functions, all of that information that came from Classic was carried over. So this definitely will provide all the information they already had, which is nice. Now, for those districts that did not migrate over and they're starting new in inventory, what's nice is they don't have to set this stuff up ahead of time. They can if they want, maybe locations, they want to import those in. But when you import the item spreadsheets, out of all, you know, if they have multiple years worth of items that they want to import in, if it doesn't have the code already exists, like if the asset class isn't already stored in asset classes under core, when they import that spreadsheet, it will automatically add that asset class into core. Now, the only thing it doesn't do is, and I'm going to click on asset classes here, is it doesn't put in the description. It just says user imported. So that's one thing that, you know, would have to be modified then if you're going to let those core codes be added when the item spreadsheets are imported. And really, that's not so much of a big deal either for most of these because they may not have a lot of asset classes. They might not have a lot of funds. So it's easy for them to go in and just edit these and add the descriptions. Or like locations, for example, if they do not add these ahead of time, that's okay too, because if, you know, it adds all the locations with the user imported description, you can export these out and into a spreadsheet, add the descriptions and import them back in, and it will update the descriptions from user imported to whatever they entered in on the spreadsheet. So, so there's, you know, a lot of workarounds with this as well. So I'm going to touch upon, a few of these core options out here, just because, you know, some of these, you know, are pretty basic. Here's where my asset classes are. Not a big deal. Here's where my category codes are. But some of these, like the configuration and the fiscal year, look a little bit different. They're not set up. They may not be set up in a grid format, or they just work differently. So I'm going to first go in. And I'm going to go into the configuration here. Okay, so when a district migrates over, you know, when they migrated over from Classic, whatever current fiscal year they were in, so if they were in fiscal year 23 or 22, when they migrated over, it's going to know that. And when that data gets migrated over, it's going to know what their last fiscal year is. So if they migrated over in calendar or in fiscal year 23, the last year closed is going to be 6/30/22 because fiscal year 22 would have been the last year that they closed. And so that's where that's coming from. Obviously, the IRN and the district name are migrated over. The fiscal year and report bundle email address, we didn't have anything like that in Classic. So these are certain fields that they're going to have to set up. And we have underneath our fiscal year and report bundle the steps on how to set them up to make sure that when they close the fiscal year, the report bundle that gets generated in a zipped format gets emailed to whoever is entered in here. So I'm just based on support tickets that I've seen, I see that some ITCs definitely put, you know, the treasurer's email in there, maybe the inventory person, their email, and they even put maybe one or two people from the ITC so that they know they get the email as well, just to know that everything's working okay and stuff like that. So it's totally up to, you know, the district on who they want underneath this email address, but you can enter multiple email addresses in here. The foundation is something, and you'll notice too, when you like move your mouse, it will give you a little tooltip here. And so the foundation is the percentage to determine the amount of the building value to exclude as the foundation of the building. In Classic, we used to have EIS 401 insurance values report that took the information out of the foundation and created a report for it. Based on the focus group and feedback we got from others, when we released inventory, they felt that the 401 was not needed, that districts have other ways to get that information, spreadsheets and other things to get that those insurance values for their insurance companies, for their appraisers and stuff like that. So this is basically an informational field. So it's not going to have any effect on any reports that are run. You know, if they wanted to, you know, find those building, they can go into the items grid and filter, first go into the item category, find the ones that are labeled with building, and then from there, take those item categories and filter them from the items grid to pull up those tags that are related to the building foundations. And then they can extract that out and put it in a spreadsheet and, you know, enter in and tweak the information they need to send to their insurance companies if they want to. So that's basically, you know, what this field does is just basically informational at this point. I believe we do have maybe some feedback issues regarding the foundation or a 401 insurance equivalent report, but that hasn't been something that the steering committee has, decided that that was something that needed to be done soon. So those feedback issues are still sitting out there regarding that. Tag number auto populate enabled. So what this basically does is it allows them to track the tag number with a predefined. I'm going to go ahead and edit this, and I'm going to select this, and basically you can put a prefix in here. So if I want my inventory tag numbers for certain buildings or areas of this, you know, district campus, I can put in like a numeric or an alphanumeric prefix, like, TR for the track, you know, area, and all of the information that's housed in a building near the track field. And so I can put that in here. And then what happens then is that it does go out there, and when I create that item, it's going to use that prefix. So that's just something. I don't know how popular this is, but we did have requests for it. So that's why we put it in here. Obviously, you can overwrite the tag number when you're creating an item. But, you know, you do have that option of adding a prefix. Kind of similar to the requisition prefixes that we have in USAS. The gap flag, so if your gap flag was enabled in Classic and they migrated over, it is automatically enabled in inventory. So it's probably something that ITCs don't generally change. So if they are, tracking things for gap in Classic, they're going to track things for gap in the inventory system as well. By it denoting the check mark there, that means that it's enabled. And I can tell too, because this disable gap flag is up here. And if I wanted to disable gap, then once I click on that to disable it, this would be unchecked gap flag. With gap comes a lot of restrictions. There are certain things that they can't modify anymore, especially fund function and asset class, and the original costs. So, if they do, have that enabled, then they'll be able to see that when they're in the items grid or viewing an item, there are a lot of fields that are grayed out, and it's because their gap flag is set. USAS function codes, again, is just an informational message here. It's not doing anything in the system. So if they're emulating the same function codes they use in USAS in inventory, they can check mark this to say we're using the same type of format. So if I go into core functions here and I look at all of my different function codes here, these function codes here are the same function codes that they're using in USAS, basically. And these are ones that were carried over again from Classic EIS. Okay, go back to core and configuration. And the last one here is using the receive date. Some districts would prefer to use the actual receive date as the acquisition date, and not the AP invoice date. So if the district would prefer that when an item is being created, it pulls the received date instead and make sure that that's checked. And that's what it will do, the system will do. So that's core. And like I said, a lot of this is set up already when they migrated over. Now, if they are starting new in inventory, then obviously a lot of this needs to be set up ahead of time and definitely before they import items. And so that's where I was saying before that it's so important to follow those steps in the non-migration in order, so that this information. You don't have any surprises afterwards, making sure that the gap flag is enabled before they go in and start importing, their item data. So all of that's laid out. We'll get into all of that on our third day. And the other one, so I was just in configuration. The other one I want to talk about in a little more detail under core is fiscal years. And so, what this is doing is it's showing me the years that they've either are currently open, have been closed, that they've been on inventory. Now, this district may have been on Classic EIS for years. But like I said before, when they migrate over, it's going to use that current year, fiscal year, and create the fiscal year period for that. So obviously in my test examples here, they migrated over in fiscal year 22 from Classic EIS. So all of that migrated over. It pulled the dollar and life limit that they used in Classic. And at that point then they would have gone in and opened the period and made the period current, which it might just default on that, I think. And they could start continue processing in that year in inventory. So it was, you know, a migration. They were in classic EIS in 22, and then halfway through the year, they migrated over to inventory, same year, same capitalization threshold amounts here. And so from there, these hold true unless they change their cap threshold. And there's a way to do that underneath system. They can go into cap criteria and make changes. We'll talk about that when we get into the reports and things like that. But that's where they would go in and change either the dollar limit or life limit. Does a district have required to have both dollar and life? No. A lot of districts just have a dollar limit and not a life limit. They leave that as zero. But in order for an item to be considered capitalized, it must meet both. So if I created an item for $5,000 and I'm not tracking depreciation on it, I don't really have a life that I need, and I make it leave it as blank or zero, this item will not be capitalized because it didn't meet both. So that's one thing to really keep in mind when you're using the life limit in conjunction with the dollar limit. I don't know if I've come across people that just have a life limit set up for the cap threshold. It's usually a dollar limit, and then some use the life limit as well. But so, you know, looking at this district's fiscal year grid, they have, you know, they migrated over in 22. They closed the year, obviously, because it says false here. It's not an open period. Currently, it's not the current period. Can they go back and run reports from 22? They can. They don't need to open it. They just need to make that period current in order to run a schedule of change in fixed assets during that time. So, and I'm not going to lie, we've had some, you know, bugs and issues we had to try to tweak that to get that to work correctly. And I think we've got almost all of those kinks worked out. So yes, if you go and say, I want to run a report from fiscal year 23, my schedule of change in fixed assets, even though I'm in 24, you can make 23 current by clicking on it. That'll change this from false 24 and change this to true. And then I can go in and run that report, and it'll reflect the data up through the end of fiscal year 23 on those reports. So that should be working well. So we may have one more issue out there, I think, but I think for the most part, unique things, I think that's all working really well at this point. And so again, looking at this district, they basically closed out of fiscal year 23 as well. And they're currently in fiscal year 24. It is open and it is current. So meaning if I go and run a report, it's going to look at 24 values. You know, some of our reports have date ranges. Our gap reports do not. So those gap reports are counting on that current period in order to give you the data that you need. So that's basically the fiscal years in a nutshell. So obviously, once a district is ready to close for 24, they can, you know, it's up to the district. Some of them will not close yet, and they'll go and click on create to create the new fiscal year. The one thing you really want to be mindful of, though, is if you don't close the prior year, like it doesn't have an opportunity to update depreciation and beginning values. So some of those gap reports are going to be no good until you close that prior year. So, you know, if districts kind of want to keep things going that the way they did in classic, I close the year, you know, I open the new year, and then I start processing in the new year, they can do that. So, but it's, you know, if they need to reopen the prior year, they do have the ability that's to do that. That's the flexibility of the inventory system. It will allow them to do that. The only thing is, you reopen a year, you start processing in that prior year. You know, maybe you forgot a couple tags and you don't want to enter them in the current year that you're in. You want to reopen the prior year. You can do that, but keep in mind when you reclose that year, it is going to change that fiscal year report bundle, right? Because now you have more items. So that old report bundle is no longer those values, and some of those reports are no longer valid because you have reopened the period, done more processing, and reclosed it again. So again, that's something for the district and the auditors to keep in mind, that they do need to be careful about that when they reopen, that that could change balances and stuff. And we do have a couple slides that I'm going to reference when we get to that portion tomorrow. When we talk about reports, we'll talk about the fiscal year and report bundle. And I've got a slide on why doesn't my balances from last year match to my beginning balances for this year? And these could be the reasons why. So we'll talk about those tomorrow. So like I said, I touched upon the configuration menu and the fiscal years. The rest are just basically your core codes, and they're basically just in maintenance mode. So like I said, most of this migrated over. And so if I needed to add a new function, I can add that function ahead of time. And so I could go to functions and I can go and click on create and I could add that one. If you see some kind of oddities in some of my information here, it is a sample district information. So you may see some odd things like this right here. So just kind of ignore that. That's not normal to have a description without a code. That's probably because just because it's my data. Okay. And like I said, anything else too? Item categories. I can go in and create a new one if I want to. And so all this information's out here and they can generate. We do have a report called Code Listing Report that will allow them, and I'm just going to show you this since we're talking about the core codes, that allow you to generate a report of all your codes. You can be specific and say, I just want one of my locations. Maybe I just want to have those sitting by my desk. So when I'm entering items, I know what location. I can look that up real quick. So I can just click on location and generate a report of just locations. And one other thing too that you've noticed this last year that we've changed is most of our reports have a report format of PDF and CSV. So you could take that location and generate it into a spreadsheet. So that's been a nice addition. Okay, before we get started, make sure that I wanted to hit all my points here underneath the core. Do you guys have any questions before we start going into transactions? Okay, well, let's get into transactions here. And if you're following along on the PowerPoint, I'm basically going to cover grid tips when we get into transactions, and then we're going to start talking about this. So we're still at the beginning of our PowerPoint presentation here. Okay, so I'm going to pick on the items option underneath transactions, and I love the grids. I love the grids. Being a classic inventory user, oh, this is so much better. We were only able to see one item tag number. I'll call them items. I'll call them tag numbers. So forgive me, that's one and the same. But I can only see them one at a time in the classic program. So it's awesome to be able to go in and filter by certain ones. If I just want to see active items, I can go in and just hit A, and it's just going to pull up all the active items. I can sort if I want to sort by acquisition date from the oldest to the newest. I can do that. So it's great to be able to have this type of format. And again, each inventory user can customize their grid. So I've got a lot of things on here, but if I really don't care about the model and serial number, I can go in underneath the more option here and remove those. But you know, most of the stuff I see on here are things that are helpful for me when I'm in here processing. So it's, you know, each Inventory users' grids can look differently, and that's what's really nice about the software. Okay, so like I said, these grids, we have done some improvements on these in this last year or so. I think like filtering on the tag, what's really nice is I can just start drilling down and it's going to go out there and find anything that begins with that. So here's an example. You know, I just started typing it in and it shows everything that's within that range. And I can resort this to say, I want to see from the very first one it found to the very bottom one. So I really like that does that well. And with descriptions too, you can tweak this. I can start typing in the word truck and it's going to find anything that starts with truck. If I want to find any descriptions that have truck in it, I can use my percents as a wildcard. And it's going to find anything that has the word truck, whether it's at the beginning, middle, or the end. Or I can just say, I just want truck. And it's going to find anything that has either that truck is just the description or truck is at the end based on my wildcard where I entered that in. So that's really nice that we have that capability in here. Filtering locations. I think this is the biggest one that we changed here. Lately is the location category or location code. It really consists of a location code and number. So I'm just going to quick go into core location so you can see what I'm talking about. So my location codes, I've got a category and a number in here. So they're split out. But when you look at it through items, you're going to see an actual, it's combined. And so it's basically that 20-1 is my category, and then the 0007 is my number. Well, how can I go in and actually look, you know, and look those up correctly? If you know the entire location code, you can just start typing it in. If you know bits and pieces of it, that's when the wildcards come into play again. So I could say I want to see anything, and you'll see that it starts working. And it's looking for anything. And let's say I know it's got 0221 in it. And that's all I know. And I'm not sure if there's a one here or a two or a five. I can put in what I know and, you know, and include wildcards in what I don't know. And it's going to go out there and filter by that. So that's really nice to be able to do that. With dates too, we enhance that as well. So you can put in a range. So if I wanted to put in 01, 01, 24, you don't have to put the entire year, dot, dot, 03, 01, 24. It's going to go out there and find whatever's within that range. Make that bigger if I want to see everything. So again, nice to have those type of features. The filter grid is really nice when you're wanting to go in and purposely filter to extract something out, to maybe mass change something, or you want to give somebody a specific spreadsheet of data that they're or tags that they're responsible for. You can do a filter, export it out, and create a PDF or a CSV of what they want and send it to them. So this filter menu is nice. Also, you can filter on the original cost. If I want to see everything that's greater than $10,000, I can do that, and it's going to pull that up. And again, while I'm filtering, I can also sort on that as well. So those are the basic filter ones I wanted to talk about. If I do, you know, go in and filter again, let's say I'm going to pick on, go back to the acquisition date. And talking about exporting the grid items, I'm going to go ahead and click on that. And we've got two types right now. And in the past, we recommended using Excel to extract some stuff out, because the CSV option would not retain the leading zeros. So there are a lot of districts, obviously, that have leading zeros with their tag numbers. definitely leading zeros in their asset class, their fund. And if you use the CSV option before we made this improvement and then open up in Excel, it lost all the leading zeros. And unfortunately, if you don't catch that, and you go back in, you know, make changes and import it back in, guess what? You've just created a bunch of funds of one or a bunch of asset classes of just three. So it's, you know, so we made an update to improve that. With that though, and I think that was with issue INV 437. But with that issue though, we kind of had a negative impact on the Excel option. I think what was happening was it's causing extra quotation marks on some of those fields. And so when you pull up the Excel version, you're seeing a bunch of columns with extra quotation marks and it looks very messy. So we do have an issue to fix that. So for now, you know, use the CSV option. And I know that that's one that they're fixing soon too with the Excel. But for now, when you're using the export, use the CSV option, export it out. And you'll notice too, once you export it out, saves it as a CSV, you open it in Excel, you're going to get a little pop-up box asking if, you know, it'll say something like by default. Here, I'll just do it to show you. I'm going to export this out. I'm going to pull this up in Excel. Pull this over if I can. Well, it's not letting me because it's prompting me, but I'm going to do a quick screenshot of what I'm seeing here. And you guys can see what I'm talking about. So when you open it up in Excel, what you're going to get when you first start, when it tries to open it, is you'll get this message saying, by default, Excel will perform the following data conversion on this file. It will remove leading zeros if you continue with convert. So I don't want to do that. I want to retain all these leading zeros, you know, that are from, you know, inventory. So you're always going to want to say, don't convert. And so that will retain the leading zeros and basically pull it up in Excel. And then from there, you can make whatever changes you need to make to it. All right. Any questions regarding the filtering or, you know, at least the export option? We'll get into these other ones here in a little bit. Okay, I don't see any at this time. So since we're in the items grid, we're gonna go ahead and do some processing in here. So I'll pick on items because first, because items is kind of like the main one, and it, when you create an item, you know, that's what they're going to be in the majority of time when they're doing processing, is they're going to be going in the items grid and creating them. And when you create an item, it will also create an acquisition record at the same time. So this is all listed underneath that PowerPoint. When you get to the item transaction, it talks about all of this. So like I said, an acquisition record will get created at the same time, and the item will by default be active. So we're going to go ahead and, like I said, I think my threshold was $5,000 in 5 years in order for it to be considered capitalized. And I'm currently, I know where I'm always at because it says it up here, I'm in fiscal year 24. So I'm going to go ahead and create a non-cap item. So this is the first screen you're going to see when you click on create. And basically, it's like the acquisition window, per se, is where you're actually going in in either pulling something from the pending file that's sitting out there waiting to be pulled in as a tag, or you can bypass the pending file altogether and manually enter in the information. Most districts use the pending file. So what's nice is I can either click on the down arrow and find the one, or I can just start typing something in. So let's say it's 86, I think I've got one here, 84631. There we go. And so it's smart enough to go out there, look at your pending item grid, which we'll talk about here in a little bit, and it will display, you know, I could have more than one regarding this PO. I could have four items out there that are in the pending file for this purchase order. In this example, I just have one, and it's nice because it shows me, obviously, PO number, the item number tied to that PO, and the invoice number tied to it. So I can confirm, yep, that's the one that I want. And the minute I click on that, it pulls the information in. So it's going to everything but the tag number, because I'm in control of the tag numbers. So I'm going to enter in the tag number that I wanted to. If I wanted to let it auto increment, I could do that as well. That was found out there underneath core. But I'm just going to put in a tag number. I think most do. I think some districts, and I don't know, maybe it's still old school, but I don't know, you know, but I think some of them have like actual physical tags, and they want to make sure that the next number that they enter in is an actual physical tag they're going to place on that item. So I can understand why they want a little more control over the tag numbers. They might have different buildings using different tag numbers. So this, you know, the person that's entering in the inventory for this building has these sets of tag numbers they use, you know, especially for some of the larger districts, they had may have multiple people entering in inventory items. And so basically I'm going to go ahead and enter in an actual tag number. And I don't know if this one's on file. I guess we'll find out. The acquisition, it defaults to acquisition type, which is most of the time what they're going to be selecting. It is defaulting on today's date, and that's fine because I'm in fiscal year 24. So I'm just going to leave that go. Also, well, that says 3-7. I'm sorry. That's probably based off of the AP invoice date. So it's either the AP invoice date or it's the received date. So that should be pulling in correctly based on what that AP invoice or received date is on the pending file. It pulls in the account code. And that again is on the pending information. And then the vendor, the PO date, the amount, and the PO information, which obviously that's what we searched for in the first place. So the pending file can be a huge benefit for districts to use the pending file. You know, they do have to do some maintenance to keep that updated, but in the long run, it saves them a lot of time because they can go in and just let it basically do the work for them. So if everything looks good on here, I'm basically in. Before I go move on to the next step, you'll see some things that aren't filled in. And so they do have the ability to enter in a grant ID and a grant year. Error correction is something that they may enter in based on an item that should have been added in a prior year. That's usually something that's done though in the acquisition record after they create the item. And then the fund, a function, asset class, again, are things that they don't normally, they really can't go in and change at this point. Those will get set when we get to the next screen, and they'll apply the asset fund function and asset class for this particular item. Once they save the item, it'll display it, and it will also display it in the acquisition. So basically, once we're done with this screen, we're moving on to the next portion of the item, in order to complete it. And then this information then is going to be displayed underneath transactions, acquisitions, to repost this item. This is the acquisition information. So I'm going to go ahead and click on continue. Yeah, I knew that was going to happen. All right, I'm going to add a couple more numbers. There we go. So at this point, I moved on to the next part. Nothing's been added yet. So if I, you know, got to that acquisition portion, I realized, oh, I'm on the wrong thing. I just need to get out of here and start all over. I can click on cancel. It'll take me out and not save anything. And I can start over. The item should stay on the pending file as well so that you can pull it in later. And so at this point, then I'm filling in the rest of the information. So if this is an item that has serial and model numbers, I can put that in here. You'll notice right now the capitalized flag is not checked. And my original cost is $759. So right there, I'm not going to meet the cap threshold of $5,000. Even if it was higher than 5 years, it still won't be capitalized because the amount does not meet the capitalization threshold of $5,000. So this will be a non-cap item once I complete it. And so basically what districts can do is just use their tab key to tap through here to enter in this information. You know, the item category, they can click on the down arrow or they can just start typing it in and pull one in. The number of items, obviously this is being pulled from the pending file, it's just one. We're gonna talk about split items here in a little bit and we're gonna go through how to split an item as well. And that's usually, and that is for items that are greater than one, that have a number of items greater than a one. And so all of this information got pulled in from my pending file, which really saves me a lot of time. If I use organization codes, I can pick one. If I use condition codes, I can pick one. Underneath my location codes, I'm just going to pick maintenance. Like I said, it defaults to active. My replacement in insurable values will always be the same as my original cost when I'm creating an item. So those populate with the same value that's in the original cost. And these are other fields that I can mark down if I want to. So that takes care of like the ID information and the current information. I'm going to scroll down a little bit. And now we're at the acquisition information. So again, that acquisition date came from my invoice. Either it was the invoice date or the received date. The acquisition method by default will be purchased. I can change this if I want to these other options. And if this is a capitalized asset, then it will show up on like the fixed asset by source report based on my acquisition method. Beginning balance, the beginning balance is going to be zero. One, because this is not a capitalized asset, and two, because it wasn't included in the capitalized information at the beginning of the year. So if this item was a capitalized asset, it met the cap threshold, my beginning balance would still be zero because the item was acquired this year. It wasn't acquired in a prior year, so no beginning balance will be set for this item until I close the year. And if it's a cap item, then it's going to put that original cost amount and set the beginning balance with that amount. Obviously, because I have my gap flag enabled, you'll see some of this stuff I can't touch. Original cost, I can't just go in here and start changing the original cost. I added that in the prior screen. And if it's wrong or something, I would need to go in, cancel out of here, start over and change that on my acquisition window that I started with. The depreciation information, I believe it does default with straight line. And so if this isn't something you're tracking depreciation on, you can select none and there'll be no depreciation tracking on it. The beginning date, it's always going to default again to the invoice date. That can change as well. However, we don't, recommend if you acquired the item and it was, on March 7th, then it wouldn't make any sense to put in a February date for the beginning date. It should be within the month that, you acquired that item. Life expectancy, if you're tracking depreciation, you do need a life expectancy in here. That's the way that it's going to calculate life-to-date depreciation. When we get in depreciation on day three, we'll talk about all the different fields on the item record that are used to calculate depreciation. Salvage value, if there is a salvage value, you sell it, it's worth $50. You can put that in here. And the life-to-date depreciation, again, you can tell I can't go in and change this or make changes. That's a big difference from classic. Classic, you could go in and edit the life to date whenever you wanted. And I think that got people into trouble, to be honest. We noticed that life to date figures were not the right figures. We found that out while districts were migrating. And so we had a document that we posted out there in the wiki during that time saying you got to go out there and make sure their life to date figures are correct and classic before you migrate them over. And for those of you that already did migrate them over, you should be doing these steps to make sure that things are correct. We had discussions with the Auditor of State's office on it as well. They put out a bulletin about it as well. And I think I have that linked. When we talk about depreciation on day three, I'll show you where that information's at. But they put out a message to their field auditors explaining this as well. Why those things weren't caught to begin with in Classic, I don't know. I can't explain that. But districts were able to go in and just make changes to their life to date by just putting in whatever they wanted here and not letting the system do the calculation for them. So we prevented that in redesign. So you have to create a depreciation transaction in order to update the life-to-date depreciation so that we have an audit trail of why the depreciation was changed. And so in here, you would click on create and you'd be able to put in the type, the description explaining why you're changing the depreciation and the amount. So we'll get into that here in a little bit, but that's one way of updating your life-to-date depreciation. And so, because I'm not tracking depreciation on this item, I really could care less about the rest of these. So, I'm just going to go ahead and move on. If I have any lease information, I could enter that information in. And if I have any user-defined information that I'm tracking specifically for our district, I can use one of these user-defined fields to enter that information. And then I could use it to run reports and things like that. I've got everything I need. If I don't, it will tell me. So I'm going to click on Save Item. And it saved it. It changed it now to an edit mode that I can click on Edit to edit anything. If I realized, I forgot to put in my organization code, that's okay. I can go in and click on Edit, and it'll allow me to go in and make a change to that. You'll notice the ones that are grayed out are things that we cannot change because the gap flag is enabled. So I can't just go in and change my fund or my function. Now that I've saved the item, if I realized my function code was wrong, I would have to create a transfer transaction to point it to the correct function code. So that would require another transaction, but they're tied, they're linked. So if I had to do that, I now have an item, an acquisition, and a transfer transaction all tied to the same item. Okay. Obviously, close will allow me to close out of here. Add acquisition will allow me to add an additional acquisition to this existing item. So if I had maybe three purchase order items, on my pending file, but I don't want to create three separate tags. I want to pull all of those in under this one tag. I could use add acquisition at this point to create an additional acquisition. And when I do that, it's going to take me to that acquisition window, I can pull it from the pending file and I can add it on here. So when I'm done, maybe I have two or three to do. When I'm done adding those additional acquisitions, then if I go and look at that item, I can't tell from the items grid that I have three acquisitions, but I can tell when I go to the acquisitions grid and I enter in that tag number, it's going to have three acquisitions listed on the grid. That tells me right away I've got three acquisitions tied to this. So, you know, this does happen quite often. They just don't want to split out and have a bunch of tags when they just want, they may have a bunch of pending items that they just wanted to all fall under that tag. Then the only way to do that is either do the add acquisition here at this point when you're creating, after you've created the item, or you can go under transactions, the acquisitions option, and add additional acquisitions there. And we'll go through an example of that when we talk about the acquisitions grid. Recalculate. What's nice is it got the nice little hover. It updates original cost if it does not equal the acquisition total. This happens. I don't know if it's a byproduct of Classic, but if your total acquisitions should match the original cost. So if, you know, you purposely say, if you went in, created an additional acquisition to say update original cost, you had an item for $1,000, you do an additional acquisition against that item for $500, you select update original cost, your new original cost for that item is $1,500, and you have two acquisitions against it. For some reason, if those two acquisitions do not add up to the $1,500, and it's the two acquisisions, one reflects $1,000 and another one reflects $499. This system, the original cost is based off of those acquisitions. So if that original cost amount is not right, it really should be $1,499. This recalculate option will allow you to update the original cost to equal whatever's sitting out there on those acquisitions. You know, if there's two acquisitions out there and they total $1,499, it's going to go out there and recalculate this. It doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. So, and I really think, you know, we've pretty much locked in inventory to not cause that. But if it's something that came from Classic, this is a quick fix. And I believe the recalculate is an admin option, I'm pretty sure, that I believe that ITCs would have to do. I'm pretty sure there. And it does explain it in the documentation as well. The split is, we're going to talk about that here in a little bit. And because it's grayed out, the reason it's grayed out is because my number of items is just one. I can't do a split on just one. So obviously, if they pulled in something from a pending file where they have, you know, benches, you know, and they've got three sets of benches that they want to split out, you know, the number of items could be three, it could be higher. And I'll explain that here in a little bit. But they have control over how they, you know, want to split them, more flexibility than, what they had in Classic. So it's a really nice feature, but obviously I can't do it on this one because my number of items is one. So, you know, I created this tag and I'm going to highlight the tag because, you know, it's in items now. If I close out of here, here it is. And also, if I go and look at this item, my information on it, I can go and view it again if I want. I can edit it. And because I added it this year, and this year hasn't been closed, you'll notice that it allow me to delete it as well. So if this, if it wouldn't, the trash can icon would be grayed out. So I'm also going to go up to the acquisition. And And I can see the acquisition related record as well. And if I just view this, obviously this looks very familiar. Remember when we first created the item, it was the acquisition information. So it's stored, like I said, in the acquisition grid. And so, like I said, you can have multiple acquisitions for one item. That add acquisition option will allow us to keep adding acquisitions to an existing item. But I can also do that in here. And I don't want to jump ahead. We're going to go back to items and do a split, but I'll show you here in a minute how to do an additional acquisition to an existing item. All right. So I'm going to go back to the items grid. Any questions while I'm looking through my notes here in the next exercise? Okay. And so, like I said, I created a non-cap item. So this time I'm going to create capitalized item. But before I do that, I want to show you guys the impact that can make on some of the gap reports. And I think I'm just going to pick on the schedule of change in fixed assets so you can see what a capitalized asset's impact is on those gap reports. So before I add this cap item, I'm going to go ahead and go to the gap reports. And like I said, I'm just going to pick on one of them. I'm going to pick on the schedule change in fixed assets. And I usually use the asset class because usually districts don't have that many asset classes. And it's just easier to read the report versus the fund and the function. And I'm going to pick on just the summary just to see a nice summarized version of the report. And I'm just going to generate this. And this is the, and we're going to get into greater detail on this fixed assets, the summary schedule of fixed assets tomorrow, but doesn't hurt to hear things a couple times, right? So this is showing us by asset class, by the fund type, fiduciary, governmental, proprietary. And so it's always going to split it out that way. So my O3 asset class, which is fixtures, furniture, and equipment. Here is the beginning value. So these are all the capitalized assets, beginning value at the beginning of the year. And then the rest of these columns are what took place during the year, hence why it's called a schedule of change. What changes took place during the year? Did I acquire more items that are involved in this particular asset class? If I did, it would show up on the acquisition amount. And that's what we're going to focus on. We're going to add, I think I'm going to add a bus. I'm going to add a bus. And so if I'm adding a bus, it's under the vehicles, the O4 asset class. And so right now it's currently at 222,000. I'm going to increase that by about 80,000 or so. So we should definitely see this amount increase once we add that item because it's a new item that was acquired this year. If I disposed of some capitalized assets this year, they'll show up on the disposition. They're included in the beginning value because they were capitalized assets at the beginning of the year, but now I disposed of them. So the original cost is going to show up here and it's going to negate that. So, and you know, we'll get into this more tomorrow, but it's going to show up in here. Any transfers and adjustments I did as well, anything I did throughout the year that caused a change, those changes will be reflected in these fields to give me an ending balance for the year. And what's nice is our detail report will then provide the tags that make up these amounts. It will not provide the tag numbers for the beginning balance. That could be hundreds and hundreds of items, but it is going to show you what has changed throughout the year? What supports these figures? How do I know the tags that make up this $39,000? Run a detail report and you'll see it. You'll see the tags that make up the 39. So we'll do the same thing. Running one for the buses, what or whatever vehicles the district acquired through the year. That detail report will show them. So this is kind of our before. So I'm going to go back now and I'm going to go to items and I'm going to create a bus. And I'm going to do this one manually instead of pulling it from the pending file, just so you can see the difference and see how much more work it is when you create it manually. And so I'm totally bypassing the pending file. And yeah, I think I have something in here. Hopefully that will work. And again, I've been acquired. And right now, I mean, I'm not pulling this from the pending file, so I have to put in the date that I acquired this, and I'll just use today's date. The account code is not getting pulled from the pending file, so I have to know what that account code is, and I've got the purchase order information next to me, then, you know, I'd have that information, and I'm going to pick on I don't think it really looks at the validity of what you enter in here. So you do have to be careful that you put in the dimensions correctly. And then it's going to allow you to put in whatever vendor number you want in here. Like Bus Depot, how's that? The PO date, I would have to know what that is. The amount of the bus, let's say it's about $84,000. The actual PO number. So again, I would have to know that it isn't coming from the pending file. Item number one, and I don't have a check number at this point. Let's see, I do. So I've got, what I need to continue with this item. So if I don't, it'll tell me. So I'm going to go ahead and click on continue item. And at this point, I'm kind of looking to see that information that I entered in there should have been carried forward in here. So I do see that some of these are already pre-filled. And again, if I look over at capitalize, it's not capitalized yet. Even though my threshold is 5,000, I haven't met that 5 useful life years yet. So that will not be checked until I do that. So if I've got, I'm just going to go ahead and tap through here. And bus number 84. And the category, I could start typing in the bus. I'm not sure if I've got anything. Transportation, I really didn't check ahead of time. If I've got stuff for vehicles. I don't think I do. And that's okay. I'll just pick on something here. And then the number of items, I have to put in one because it didn't pull in. The entity ID, I didn't mean to blow past that here. This would be used primarily if you've got items that are in a lot. Like a lot of chairs, a lot of books, where you are never going to split them out into their each individual tag. You want to keep it as a lot, but because you're keeping it as a lot, it is exceeding your capitalization threshold and you don't want it to. So in order to make sure that it doesn't get included on your gap schedules and it's not considered a capitalized asset, you enter in an entity ID. I've seen all kinds. I've seen people non-gap, no gap, any, you know, custom field that they have. And what happens then, it'll still show up as capitalized. It'll be marked here. But when you run the gap reports, the first two prompts you see on the gap reports and some other non-gap reports is, do you want to include or exclude entity IDs? And if you say, I want to exclude entity IDs, it's going to prompt you for the entity ID you want to exclude. So if I set up this and said non-GAAP, and I put that in, those items will not be included on the GAAP report. Because, you know, if I split them out into their own individual tag, they'd all be non-capitalized. But because I'm keeping them in a lot for convenience sake, I don't want them to be shown as a capitalized asset because, you know, they were all individual, they wouldn't be. So that's one way of ensuring that those do not get included on the reports. We've got that as an FAQ and noted in the documentation as well that explains that in more detail. I'm going to pick on my fund function and asset class. So I'm going to say that this is general fund. And I'm going to say that this is probably the 2800 transportation. And this is a vehicle. I got to be careful about this because when I run that GAAP schedule afterwards, I'm sorting it by asset class. And I want to be able to see that this made an impact. Organization code, if I've got one there, where is this at? It's in the bus garage, which I'm not sure why that one doesn't have a code, but I'm going to go ahead and just start entering stuff in here and pick one. And again, because I put in 84,000 as my original cost, it's going to pre-populate replacement and insurable value with the same amounts. My acquisition date is going to be whatever I put in the prior screen. And then my obviously, it will. It's not part of beginning balance because it's acquired this year. My original cost came from the prior screen. I can't go in and just change that from here down to my depreciation information. I'm using straight line. Factor is used with the declining balance, and we'll talk about that on day three. My beginning date is the same as my acquisition date. So, like I said. You know, putting in something before this, you're going to get an error like in a prior year or a prior month. But you do want to make sure that the beginning date is on or after the acquisition date. My life expectancy, boy, I hope this bus lasts me a while because it's 84,000. I'm going to give it 10 years and I don't have any salvage value for it. And if once I put in that life expectancy too, I could scroll back up. It's not marked yet, but it should be marked once I save this item that it's going to be capitalized because I've met the 5,000 capitalization threshold in 5 years. So at this point, then I'm going to go ahead and save this item. And you'll notice now that capitalized is checkmarked. So this is now considered a capitalized asset. I'm going to go ahead and close this. And I'm going to go back and run that report again. And so I'm going back into GAAP and the fixed assets by asset class. And I'm just running the summary report at this point. And now it's showing 306,168. If I go look at the one that I did before that, it was 222,168. So it increased it by that $84,000. It's now 306,168. So that's how these GAAP schedules get updated when you add an item. So hopefully that was just kind of helpful to see that and see how that gets impacted. When you're processing capitalized assets in the system. Okay, any questions so far? You know, I just kind of took us through creating a capitalized and a non-capitalized item through the items option. If not, I'd like to do a split. And I think I've got an item already. And so I'm going to take a look at this item first to talk about it. And so this is a bunch of benches that were ordered. and there were five bench sets. And so at this point, it's just one tag. Well, I want to split this up into three, not five, three different tags. Because of the purpose, I'm, you know, probably most of the time, I don't know, it's hard to say, they're probably going to split them up into five different ones. But I wanted to show you some of the flexibility that we've incorporated in this split feature so that districts are aware that they can do this. If I, you know, want to say, you know, one of these benches is going to elementary, I've already got that located. One of them's going to the junior high and the other three are going to the high school. So I want to split them out, one, one, and three. Total's five, but I'm going to have three separate tags. And so in order to do that, you'll notice that the split item is active. So because my number of items is five, so I'm going to go ahead and click on split. And it's going to pull in the original tag number and then the starting tag. So as long as there aren't any tag numbers after this, the sequential tag numbers, 12130, 12131, and 12132 are not currently being used, then I can just use the original tag number as the starting number. So if 31 and 32 aren't being used, I'm good. Obviously, I've got this validate input to verify that, which is nice. And it will tell me 31 and 32 already used, you got to use, are already been used, they're already on the system, you got to find something else, then that's what I'll do. But I think I'm good, so I'm just going to leave that as is. This is the important part, is how many number of tags. And what I really like is if I forgot, because I can't see it because it's covered up right now, it says my max is five because that's my current number of items is five. So it tells me I can't go past that. And I don't want to go even to five. I want to go to three. Like I said, one elementary, one junior high, and three for the high school. And it also gives me original cost. These are some of the newer things that we've added. So you can see, hey, this is what it was, $10,000 originally. I'm going to validate this number by doing a validate input. So that went well. So at this point, if I wanted to go ahead and just split, I could, but I first want to edit this. And so at this point, it's kind of trying to figure out what I want here, right? So it's going two, two, and one. Is that how you want this to be? Or do you want to change this? Well, I do. And so what's really nice about this is it allows me to go in and say, yeah, this should be one. If I had any serial or model numbers, I could put that in here, as well as organizational codes. I could enter that in. My location is good because I have one set going to the elementary. And you'll notice too, what's really nice is it will start recalculating what the original cost will be then for that new item. And then 12131, this is going to the junior high. So I'm going to change that to one. And you'll see it updated original cost right away. And again, my location is going to be different. I'm going to pick on the middle school. And then my last one is really three. I've got three going to that. And you'll notice it changed it to 6,000 and it's going to the high school. And so down here at the bottom is kind of a self-check as to, even though I'm splitting it out into three different tags, the original number of items is still five and it lists it here as well as the original cost. That should match this up here. So everything looks good. I can validate this to make sure everything on my screen is good. And then I can even run a projection, which I really like because it sets it by default. So if I go and just run split item now, it's just a projection report. And it will clearly tell me this was your original tag and now it's being split. And basically that 30 is going to now just be one, 31 is going to have one, and 32 is going to have three. And so if my projection looks good, what's nice is this window stays open and I can just uncheck the projection and click split item again. And it'll basically show me the same report. And now when I look at 12130, it's just one item for $2,000. And if I go and close out of here and just do a filter, I see my three different tags. I know a question that we've received in the past is people asking about splitting an existing tag, maybe something that's been out there for a while, maybe a lot that was sitting out there where, let's say, you had 50 chairs and 10 of them got destroyed for some reason. And you want to split those off so they're no longer included in that count in that lot. You can take that item and split it into two different tags, leaving 40 on the one and 10 on the other, and generate those two tags. And then take that one that has the 10 and dispose of it. And that's an easy way to split a lot. And dispose of that specific one. And again, all of this information is listed in our FAQs. I'm going to get rid of some of these extra reports I have here. I'm going to go to our user manual and I'm going to go down to our appendix. And we do have an inventory FAQ section that goes in and goes through all of this. We've tried to divide it up into the different areas. And then there is a miscellaneous section that just talks about miscellaneous type of processes and how you do them in inventory. But we'll keep adding to this for sure when we run across tickets where they've been asked a few times, like, this might be a good FAQ. And so we'll include those on there. Okay, any questions? Kind of pretty much went through most everything on the item. Like I said, the depreciate portions of the item grid I'll talk about on the third day. So any other questions about items at all before we get into acquisitions? I don't see anything in chat either. Guys are just soaking it in, right? All right, so acquisitions grid. Like I said, these are the acquisitions that make up the item's amount. When you create an item, it will always create an acquisition. If it doesn't, there's a problem. And in Classic, that was a big problem. That it, some of that stuff was so old. And that stuff migrated over. And if there was never an acquisition record to begin with, it migrated over that way. There wasn't any cleanup done beforehand. Then the item's going to come over without an acquisition. And those type of items are reflected, especially if they're capitalized, on the GAAP reports as acquisitions prior to system startup. And you've probably seen that on the GAAP reports going, where is that coming from? It's either because the item doesn't have a related acquisition, or the fund of the item is not on the acquisition, that this source fund. So again, we'll talk about that tomorrow when we go into the GAAP reports. But like I said, the items, each item in inventory is always going to create an acquisition record. Whether you're adding the items manually, just like we did, in the prior exercises, or whether you're importing them using our system import, it's going to create acquisition records. So let's say you have, and just to kind of go where we're at on here, I'm on slide six here talking about the different acquisition information. And so on here, what I want to do is I want to go in and create an additional acquisition against an existing item. I cannot create an acquisition in here if I don't have an existing item on file. This will not allow me to say, let's say I have a brand new item, a new bus, and I'm like, okay, I'm going to create the acquisition first before I can create the item. It's not going to let you. It has to have an existing before you can create an acquisition. So really the only reason, or the main reason why you would be using acquisitions, is to create an additional acquisition against an existing item. You very well could have, someone's entering an item and they entered in the wrong amount. Well, we know now that when you go into items, you can't just go in, change the original cost. It won't let you when you pull it up because you've got the gap flag enabled. So how do I change that original cost? I entered in the wrong thing. You create an acquisition transaction, and that will allow you then to update the original cost. Or let's say, I missed an item on the pending file. I meant to add three items or three acquisitions to this one item, and I forgot one. That's okay. I already added the item. I'm out of the screen. How can I add that third acquisition? You go in here and click on Create Acquisitions and pull from that pending file. So let's try one of these out here. And I'm first going to pick on that bus that we already did, just to view this one, just so you can see what was created. Like I said, we went through that area when we first created the bus, provided, that we manually entered in all of the acquisition information for it. And so the fund function and asset class is coming from the items area as well, showing us what we selected when we created that item. So if I wanted to go in here and let's say my amount was incorrect, it should have been 85,000. I can go in and let's say this was even an item that I added the bus last year, and I went through an audit and they're like, your PO says this, but yet on the system, it shows less in inventory. And so you're like, I got to change that in here. Well, it's already another year. And you're like, how do I go in and make that change? It's okay. You can go into acquisitions and still make that change. You don't have to reopen the new year. What you can do is go in and click on create. And you would enter in that existing tag number. Has to be an existing one in here. And whatever date you want to put in here. If this was something like where it was a mistake, like, oh, I did not add that on there. And I want to go in and add something on here. What I can do is I can put in an extra $1,000. Okay, maybe it should have been 85,000. Here's the key right here. Update original cost. It's going to update that by the extra $1,000. And then from here, when I click on, let me see if there's anything else I really need. The error correction. I want to talk about this one too. In my case, let's say this item was added a year or two ago, and it was caught through my audit that I didn't have the right amount in inventory. What I can do, and because this is a capitalized asset, I can mark that as an error correction. And what that will do then is it's not truly an acquisition that happened this year. It's correcting something that was incorrect, right? So it's an error correction. So when I check mark this, then that $1,000 is not going to be reported underneath the acquisition column on my gap schedule. It's going to be recorded underneath the adjustment column on my gap schedule. And so as long as I have my update original cost and my error correction, say, hey, this should have been from a prior year. So please, on my gap reports, throw it on the adjustment column and not on the acquisition column. That's what it's going to do. And when I click on this, it's going to create that additional acquisition for the $1,000. And then if I go and look at that item, It's now 85,000 instead of 84. So that's a way to create an acquisition, and create an acquisition that should have been done in a prior year. So hopefully that kind of helps to see how you can they can go in and do that. That's basically what that acquisition grid is basically used for, is making either adding additional acquisitions to an existing item or making a correction to an existing item because you can't do it in the item screen. So you got to do it in here. So those are the main reasons why they would use that. Let's see. In our FAQs, just to go back to that, when I go in and scroll back up to the top, we, have some just reminders of different things that you can do via the acquisition grid. How do I add an acquisition with a prior date to an existing item? How do I edit one? Can I delete one? So it just has those guidelines here and very quick questions that a lot of your districts may have, and you can just refer them to the FAQ page and they can look that information up. So just a handy wiki page for the end users. Okay, any other questions about acquisitions before we move on to the other options and transactions? I'm going to pick on dispositions. So if I created an item this year, or let's see, I'm sorry, I created an item several years ago. I no longer use it. How do I get rid of it? You can't just go in and just delete it. It's not going to let you because it's from 15 years ago. You have to dispose of it. Especially if it's a capitalized asset, you have to dispose of it. And so this is the grid that you're going to use to dispose of those items. And one thing you want to keep in mind is that this filter is filtering items that have already been disposed of. So if you're like, oh, I want to dispose of, tag number 12126, and I'm looking it up, I'm like, well, it's not on here. Well, we got to remember these are just the disposed of items. So you want to create a disposition transaction in order to do that. And so that'll allow you then, and I'm just gonna, I don't have one in mind here, but in here, you can start filtering or you can use the drop down and it's gonna find and pull that in here, which is really nice. And then it's defaulting to today's date as the disposition. It's gotta be in an open period. It's going to pull in the description of that item. If you've received any money for that item, this is just an informational field. So you could put that in here if you wanted to. I received 20 bucks from it. I can do that. My disposition code, these have to exist underneath core dispositions. And then I would just select the one that I want. Who authorized it? Again, this is informational, it's not required. It pulls in the original cost of the item and the number of items in here. It also pulls in the fund, function, and asset class of that item. So that stuff's just in here just to see the information that's tied to it. If this was something that I should have disposed of in a prior year, and I forgot, I can use the error adjustment. So again, if this was a cap, it's not a big deal with non-cap items. But for your cap items, if you forgot to dispose of a truck because you sold it 2 years ago and you forgot to put it in here, you don't want to reopen that period, or you can't because it's an archived period. The way to do that is to create the disposition now in the current year and make sure that the error adjustment is checked. And so what happens then is that item will not go under the disposition column on the gap reports. It'll show under adjustments. And obviously, the related detail report of that gap report is going to show the tag number as to why. But again, that's what the error adjustment is mainly for, is, you know, I didn't do it in a prior year. I need to account for that this year. I don't want to reopen the period because I just don't or I can't. So I'm going to do it this year and mark it as an error adjustment so that it records it properly on my GAAP reports. And so basically, once it's done, you create it, it adds it to the disposition grid, and now you have an item. So I'll just go ahead and do it with this one, 000083. So it goes ahead and adds it here. And then if I go back and look up that particular item underneath items, there it is. It should say that it is disposed of. So again, we have FAQs about dispositions and what you can and can't dispose of versus what you can and can't delete. So I believe all non-cap items, regardless, if they're non-cap, regardless of the year they were entered in, I believe you can delete those. I think it's, yeah, I look here, see how these are all active. So I can, but is when I get to a capitalized asset, that changes. I can't just go in and just delete a capitalized asset. I have to dispose of it. Okay. I'm going to move on to transfers, unless you guys have any questions. And this particular instance doesn't have any transfer transactions, but this is used if you need to change the fund function or the asset class of an existing item. Because I have the GAAP flag enabled, I just can't go into an item and change those three fields. I must create a transfer transaction. And when I do that, and I'll pick on one here. It's going to pull up the original cost of that item. It's going to use today's date as the disposition date. And then from here, it's asking me, what do you want to change? The fund, the function, or the asset class? And I think for this one, I'm going to pick on the function, and it pulls up the old value. It says currently it's 2,500. Well, it really should have been labeled underneath the principal. So I've got the new value. And again, the error adjustment. If this was something that should have been taken care of in a prior year, I can create an error adjustment. And what happens is instead of it flowing from the transfer in and out columns on the GAAP schedules, it'll instead include it on the error adjustment column on the GAAP schedules. In this case, this is something that I'm taking care of this year, so I'm not going to mark the error adjustment, and I'm going to click on create. And when I do that then, and I look up this tag, it'll now show the new value of 2421. And like I said, if this was a capitalized asset, then when I run my GAAP schedules, I'm going to see on the transfer in and out, the transfer out column is going to show the 2,500 going out or the 2,000 going out of the 2,500 and the 2,000 going into the 2421 function on the GAAP report. So it's basically a wash. It's just moving it from one function to another. Okay. Not a whole lot with, once we get through items, these other ones are real basic. So not a whole lot to them. What they, you know, have to do transaction-wise. A lot of stuff happening behind the scenes, right? Because you could have an item that has, you know, several acquisitions against it. It could have multiple transfer transactions depending on what all you're transferring. If the fund function and asset class are wrong. And by the time you're all said and done, you dispose of it, you have a disposition. So you could have multiple transactions against the same under one item. Just depends on what's happened to that item throughout its life. So that's how those are all related. So the pending items is kind of the before you get into actually adding an item, right? Because these are all in regards to, you know, creating the item and anything you've done with the item after the fact. Your pending items is the information that's sitting out there that's waiting to get pulled in as a tag. And so this is talking to USAS. And the only way it's going to talk to USAS is if you use the pull from USAS option. So before we get in here and actually pull some items, I want to talk about how that works. So I am going to bring up the PowerPoint and get to that area. So like I said, these are just a holding cell of all the items from USAS, and you need to use pull from USAS to pull that information in. And it depends too, like I said, if they're using USAS to do their AP invoicing, it'll pull it from there. But also if they're using a third-party software to do their invoicing, that needs to be set up correctly on the third-party software's part in order for it to get pulled in correctly into inventory. With USAS, they need to make sure that the EIS Classic integration module and the integration configuration are set up beforehand, before the invoice. That should have been done when they migrated. Those things should have been set up once they migrated to USAS. That stuff should have been set so that when an item is invoiced in USAS, it's marked for inventory. And we're going to talk about that here in a little bit. So with that items grid, you can view items, you can delete pending items, but you can't edit or add to the pending items grid via the actual grid. And you'll notice that back here quick. All you see is a delete. You don't see a way to edit or a way to add in here. Just delete. Adding basically is the polling for USAS. Okay, this is the grid I wanted to talk about. And I did, while I was working on this training, I did make changes to the documentation, the pending items page in the documentation, try to provide more information with this grid, as well as errors that could occur when you're using the pull from USAS, just providing more information in there for the ITCs and the districts. So here's what happens. So when an invoice is created in USAS and it meets the pending threshold. So let's say my threshold set up to pull in anything that's over $500 and has a 500 and 600 object code. So what's going to happen then is it gets marked for inventory. And so here's our first process here. I'm in the USAS application. The PO is invoiced, meeting the pending threshold. The USAS inventory status is at pending. And there are ways to find this in USAS. We've got a way to do an advanced query, and we have a report definition that can be used in order to find those items that are considered marked for inventory and what their current status is. So if you, you know, create a spreadsheet and you see a bunch of them that say pending, that's telling me that it's meeting the threshold in USAS and that's it. Nothing else has happened. So when you go into inventory then, and you use the pull from USAS option, and it pulls those invoice items into inventory, it's going to change that USAS inventory status to sent. It was pending, now it's sent. That's your indication to say these items were sent to inventory. And that should be most of the time true, unless there's some kind of little hiccup or something as to why, you know, those aren't showing on the pending file in inventory. So the next thing that happens then is in inventory, when you pull that item in to as, or you pull that pending item in into a tag and you create a tag for that, it's going to update the status again in USAS. It's talking back and forth, and it's going to change it from sent to posted. So if I run a query or a spreadsheet in USAS, and this particular invoice item in USAS is showing posted now, that tells me that a tag in inventory has been created for it. And another option then that will send a message back to USAS is if in the pending file, I delete. So, if, you know, I'm back here in my pending file. If I go in and hit the trash can to delete some of these pending items off of there to remove them, that goes back to USAS and sends a rejected message, and it updates the inventory status to rejected. So again, if I go into USAS and create a spreadsheet of all those marked inventory items and I see some that say rejected, that's telling me that they were deleted from the pending file. And there probably was a reason why. And if it was accidentally deleted, what's nice is that the pull from USAS has an option that you can include rejected status items so that they can get re-pulled back into the pending file. So here's just, again, kind of what I just said. Inventory will not re-pull items with a sent or posted. That item has already been sent to inventory. I don't want to pull it again and have that item twice on my pending item grid. Also, if the item was actually, a tag was created for it, I don't want to pull the item back over because I already created a tag for it. I don't want it to appear on the pending items grid again. So it will not re-pull sent or posted statuses. But it will re-pull the rejected if you include rejected items. Otherwise, it won't pull those either. So, you know, that's where it's, you know, basically talking back and forth. So USAS and inventory both know what's going on. So what I was talking about was ways to verify that the pending items have been marked for inventory. So we do have this documented in the pending items chapter. We have a JSON file that can be downloaded and imported into the report manager that allows you then to put in a specific date, to beginning date, and it will pull all those items that are marked for inventory. So here's basically what I do have that. Let me log in just so you can see what it looks like. I do have that imported in here already. Remember what I named it. Let's say, see what I get. So items marked for inventory. So this is the one. And when I go in, I can do a query here and say, I want to pull any items that have either a starting invoice date of this, or if I'm using the receive date instead, I can put in the receive date. And then when I go in and generate this, and you'll notice too, by default, it's in a spreadsheet format. And here is my spreadsheet that was generated from this. I'm just going to make this a little bit bigger. Obviously, they're all marked for inventory. Here is my current inventory status. So this is telling me what has happened with this. So these pending ones, again, they haven't been brought over into inventory yet. They're still sitting out there waiting for me to pull. Set means that this one has been pulled, and this is sitting out there on the pending item grid. So rejected is telling me that I deleted it off the pending item grid. If I want it to come back, when I use pull from USAS, I have to check the box to say I want to include rejected. And looking here to see if I have any that have posted. Oh, here's one. And so this one is telling me here that I have created a tag number for it. So it's telling me right away, which ones are actually, what the status is, what's going on with those since February 1st are the ones that it pulled. That's one way to do this. The other way is to go in and run an advanced query underneath AP invoices. I can go in here and underneath the advanced query, I believe underneath items, inventory item equals, I think it's true. And then I can save this query. I'm going to apply it. And it's going to basically pull in the information below here on my grid all of the items that have been marked for inventory. Now, this one I can't tell what the status is. That report is a little bit nicer as it gives you a bit more information. But it is one way to verify that I, definitely, if I get an error message when I try to use pull from items saying it's giving me an error, like it can't pull anything, I would go in here and either run that spreadsheet report or I would do this query to confirm items. I don't know why it's not pulling, but it is definitely showing those to me. So I think, if you do the advanced query first and you see a bunch of them, probably run that report to see, what is the status of those particular ones? Are they all showing sent? Then I know that I don't have any ones that need to be pulled over because they all have been pulled over. Have they all are all showing as posted? Are they all showing as rejected? For some reason I wiped out my pending items grid and I need to go back in and pull them back in. What I can do is underneath pull from USAS, I can include rejected for that time period and it will pull them back in. So like I said, in our documentation, I don't know if we've got it. I don't have it in the in the PowerPoint, but if I go to the actual pending items chapter, go up in there here, transactions, items. We have an area called pull from USAS error messages. And it displays the error message you might get when you pull from USAS and what it means and the solution to that. So, and there are several. Some of these are related to the pull. Some of them may be related to the connection issues. See the test connection? If you get some kind of error in there as well, those are defined in here as well. So we just added this. I just updated this yesterday. So that's where, just a few more error messages that you guys can see in case you do get that message from your districts. Like, I'm getting this error message. What does this mean exactly? And it could be a connection issue or it could be something when you're trying to pull the items in. Okay. Any questions regarding pending items? All right. I'm almost going on 2 hours here. And the last thing I want to talk about is importing spreadsheets. It's the last thing we're going to do. So, and then we should be able to wrap things up. And so on the PowerPoint here, Basically, can I import, mass import new items? Yep. Can I dispose, mass dispose of items? Absolutely. Can I mass update fields on existing items? Mostly. And so that's what I want to talk about. We do have templates out there under our import documentation that can really help districts for those that, you know, are, you know, wanting to mass import items. And with the imports, it's only going to accept a CSV. So if you try to import a spreadsheet using our system import option and you get some kind of weird message error, you need to check sure that it isn't an Excel formatted spreadsheet, that it's CSV. So obviously when they're in there working in their spreadsheet, they're probably in an Excel formatted spreadsheet, and that's okay. They can make as many changes as they need to, update it, whatever. But when they're ready to import it into USAS or into inventory, they want to make sure that they save it as a CSV file. For me, I think it's more convenient to work out of that Excel format in case I need to go back and forth in there and make changes. My leading zeros are staying the same. Everything looks good. And that way I have like a final draft before I save it as a CSV file. Because just in case the CSV file doesn't load properly or I'm getting error messages, I can go back to my safety net of my Excel spreadsheet and make changes. Again, save it as a CSV file and import it in. So our system import, and this is the key thing I want to say, is this is used for importing transactions with transaction dates in an open period. So if I go in and all my acquisition dates for the items on my spreadsheet are all in fiscal year 24, I'm good as gold. I'm in fiscal year 24 in inventory. It's my open period. And I can go in and process those in. Now, if I've got items that have an acquisition date of 2023, not going to let me because that period is probably not open. So that's one thing to keep in mind with the system import option. Now, for those districts that are starting new in inventory and they've been, you know, keeping track of their inventory by another means, and let's say they have it on a spreadsheet and they have items from 1960 on in here with several different acquisition dates. They, with your ITC's assistance, they are going to be using the migration import under system configuration. And that will allow them then to migrate multiple archived periods items into their inventory instance. And like I said, we will be covering that in more detail on day three. So these next few minutes, we're just going to talk about the system import option. And so these are, again, are just import tips that are available. And these are for basically existing inventory data. So we're going to go through an example of, let's see here. I do have a new item spreadsheet, and I'm going to pull that up so we can talk about it, and then we're going to import that in. And then we're also going to pull items, existing items from inventory, make a change to them. I think we're going to update the locations on them to do a mass location update, and then re-import them back in, just updating the location. So I just want to talk about those two ways that we can do that. So again, under system import is where I'm going. And so I'm going to add a handful of items for 2024. And so I do have a spreadsheet out there already. I'm going to pull that up. Okay. And what I've done is, like I said, we worked pretty hard at getting these at getting these template spreadsheets that we have available. I'm going to go to where those are at, under System, Import, and their documentation. If I scroll down to like the different import types, like I'm going to import items, we have spreadsheets, template spreadsheets out here that are pre-formatted with the right, you know, format structure, dates, inventory tags, so it retains the leading zeros, so on and so forth. And this is what districts should use. They should take this template, open it up, and then start, you know, they can copy and paste it from another spreadsheet if they have to, and get it to where it's in that right format. And this really takes care of a lot of that. We do have all of the spreadsheet import formatting stuff labeled in here as well. Which fields are required, which fields aren't. So that's all listed in here as well. But you know, it might save them a lot of time using one of our template spreadsheets. So that's what I did, is I pulled up that template spreadsheet. That's why, you know, I'm seeing some of these with highlighted, because it's pulled from this spreadsheet. And we also have little tooltips in here as well. And basically, I just need to make sure that the required fields are set up and that they have the right information in them. And basically, I'm, you know, creating 9 Chromebooks. I've got a bunch of Chromebooks that I want to mass add. So I'm putting in the stuff that I need to put in regards to it. So I've got, you know, my replacement costs, my locations in here. They're all going into different locations. And you'll notice too, location category and location number have to be separated. But once we view that item in the items grid, they'll be combined. By default, the status would be A. Here's where all my, you know, texting format is correct for the leading zero, so it retains those. Any depreciation, I can put that in here as well. There's any lease information. There's so much information on that spreadsheet. For those columns that you know you aren't going to use, if this is too busy, they can get rid of those. They can delete, you have to delete the entire column, and they can get rid of those that they don't want to use, and that's fine. So I have this saved, and I have to make sure too that my item record has the I in here. That's a very key part. And then basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to go and import this in and see what I get. So I'm in import. I have to upload that file that we were just looking at. And before I do that, did I save that as a CSV? See, I'm checking myself. I don't think I did. I did it. Practice what you preach, Michelle. All right, so let me save this as a CSV first. All right, now I'm good. And then I'm going to go and upload. Here is my CSV file right here. And then what type of import type am I wanting to do? I'm wanting to do an item import. And am I updating records? No, these are brand new. Am I creating transfer transactions? No, these are brand new. Am I keeping the leading zeros? Yeah, I got leading zeros on the tag numbers. I want to keep those. Do I want to auto assign? No, I don't. I'm going to use the tag numbers that are in my spreadsheet. And so basically, I'm at the point now where I'm going to go ahead and import and see what happens. And I do get an imports results file. And I didn't try this out ahead of time, so it'll be interesting to see what we get here. Oh, look at that. And so it's giving me some good information here. And so what it's basically telling me is that an acquisition was added and an item record was added for each of these. And like I said before, when you create an item, it has to have an additional act, it has to have an acquisition record tied to it. So that's why we're seeing like two messages for each tag. And so that all looks good. So basically, what I would do as a district person is I would check these out. I would either run a report or just look at maybe the first one and the last one through my items grid or through, and the acquisitions grid just to make sure that they're there. And I've got this as a backup to say that everything was imported correctly. So that's a very simple way to create a new spreadsheet. The other thing I wanted to show you is, pulling out existing items, making mass changes, and updating those. And so I think I have a way, I got something in here. I'm going to go into items. So we're going to update locations, mass change them basically. And so I'm going to find those through my items filter. And right now, the location code for all of these is 10-1 is the item, is the location category, and 0221 is the room number. Well, it should be 0019 here. So I could go into each one of these and edit them and change the location, but if I've got 100 of them here, that's going to take a while. So what I can do is filter what I want, which these are the ones I want, and export the grid items. And I want to make sure I'm using CSV. Like I said before, we did make updates to this to protect those leading zeros. And when I pull this up, I'm going to get the message. I'm sorry, it's on my other screen asking me, do I want to remove the leading zeros? And I want to mark don't convert. Won't let me pull it over until I select this. So sorry about that. And I definitely want to say don't convert those. I want those leading zeros to stay. Here's my spreadsheet. And you'll see it, even though my items grid had, maybe 12 different columns, when I export, it doesn't just look at the 12 columns. It pulls all of the information off of the items, and all those columns are listed on here. The one thing that you want to be very careful of is because this is existing item data, for one, you don't want to touch the ID column. That is like the UUID behind the scenes. It's reading the item when you import it in back in. It's going to look at that, so you want to leave that alone. And really, for anything else that you're not affecting, leave it alone. Don't touch it. So if you go in and remove the descriptions in here for some reason by accident, and you import this back in, you're going to get those updated items with no descriptions. So, you want to be really careful that you're only modifying the actual column that you want to change and that everything else is just left the same. So I am going to go over to my locations, and my location category is okay, but my location number is not. And so I definitely want to change that. And I do want to keep the leading zero, so I'm going to change this to text. If I want to copy that, paste it. Copy that, paste it, go as far down as I want. Just basically change them all with that location number as 0019. And so at this point, I'm not changing anything else. And I'm first gonna, and if I wanted to save it as an Excel format first, I could, just in case I need to go back and change anything, I can do that. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and save it as a CSV file. And I'm using this one right here. Location import. I could have left it the same name, that's fine, but. And so at this point then, I can go back in. And right now these are going to change as 0019 by me going in here to system, import, upload that file. And again, it's an item import. I am updating records, so this needs to stay checked. I'm not creating transfer transactions. I'm not changing the fund, function, or asset class, so I'm leaving that go. I'm keeping the leading zero, sure. I'm going to go ahead and import and see what happens. And it tells me that the location number has been added. Okay. I did see something kind of different with that. I think I did not format. I'm going to go back. This is a good thing. My location category changed. And I think it's because of how it was opened in the CSV file. It changed this. Because it was, if I go back to my grid, I was looking for locations of 2001, and for some reason it changed that on my spreadsheet to 1-October. So what I should have done is made this 20-1. So I can do that now. Oops. And then from here, if I go back, then it should update that. I haven't done anything else. I'm going to say as a CSV. And then from there, I can go back in then. And go to system import. Because right now, if I would look at one of those tags that I imported in, you'll see how it changed it to 1-October-0019. And I wanted it to be 20-1. And then it was 20-1. Oh, let me check. I'm sorry, it's 10-1, not 20-1. That would make sense why it was October. So that's okay. This is fun. I'm going to go back and change it again. Should be 10-1. See how it did that? It automatically put a custom, and I don't like that. So I'm going to change this to and do 10-1 and then change the rest of them. And this stuff happens, and that's okay. Then you can see how we can change it. So it was 10-100021. Now I'm changing it to 10-100019. And when in doubt, use text. And now I'm going to save this as a CSV. I could save it as a spreadsheet first, but and so this then should correct it. So I'm going to close out of here and go back to system, import, and upload my file, which is my most recent one. And I'm going to update, no transfer transactions, import. And I don't know, maybe I didn't have that one before because it says location code added, and that's okay. So it did that, and then all of those items then now show that proper location code. So yeah, it's always good to review your import results file to make sure. So apparently I didn't have any 10-10019 before. So now that I've so it's on there, it's a new location, and all of these items then reflect that location code. So if I looked up 13935 or any of the 139s, those should all have the 10-10019. And if I would go and look at the actual location codes here. You see how it says user imported? It's because it's a new location code that I mass changed it to. It added it in here because it didn't exist already. And now I would need to go in and edit this and give it a proper description. Okay. You guys are so quiet. Any questions? All right. Well, hopefully, I know there's a lot of information in here, but I'm hoping that all, you know, just seeing that and just seeing the different options underneath transactions and what you can do to either mass enter information import via import or going into the transaction programs manually and entering that stuff. Hopefully that helped. Tomorrow, what we're going to focus on are the inventory reports. We're going to go into, I'll go back to my pen or my PowerPoint here. We're going to talk about the gap reports. And then we're going to pick on some non-GAAP reports like the book value and the audits report. And we're going to talk about the fiscal year end report bundle as well. So we'll focus on all that tomorrow. It probably won't be as long as today's session. Today we covered a lot with transactions. But if you guys don't have any other questions, hope to see you all back here tomorrow at 9 o'clock or 9 o'clock. Take care.
Thank you.
You're welcome.